Hello, we're back to the second part of the animation tutorial, and as promised I will show you how to do parallax in Clip Studio Paint. The first tool you need to know is keyframing. You can do this by turning on this enable keyframe icon on the timelines in Clip Studio Paint. When you enable this keyframe for your selected layer, you can start using this to animate your layer. There are three interpolation options: hold, linear, and smooth. For hold, it will not create in between of your keys. Linear will create equal distance in between of the keys. And smooth will create an automatic easing for the keys. The downside of using this method would be when you activate a keyframe, you can't draw on the layer until you disable it. But the keyframe will still be there, so you just need to turn it off when you want to draw on the layer. Next tool is the 2D camera folder. It's located under animation, new animation layer, 2D camera folder. This will create a box that represents your camera view, which you can set a keyframe and do transformation. This is essentially the same with the keyframing option. You will have the same interpolation settings, but instead of moving the layer, you will move this 2D camera folder. And you could still draw on the layer in one of the display modes. There is two display modes which you can switch around. You will need to be in this object subtool to see the option and go to your tool property window. One of the options is the field guide or the overall view. This will show you your whole canvas. And the other is the camera field of view. It will show you your camera view, but you can't draw on this mode. So what I prefer to do is, I will work on the field guide, and then I see my camera during the playback. To do this, you will need to go to animation, playback settings, and you need to enable render to the camera. This way you will see your camera view each time you start a playback. One last tool before I'm going to show you how to do the parallax, you will need to know how to use the perspective ruler. To create one, you can go to your layer, then right click ruler a frame and create perspective ruler. For these purposes, I'm just going to use 1-point perspective. Again, you will need to be on this object subtools in order to see the two options. I will turn on this YZ and XZ plane. You can increase the grid size with the slider or inputting the number. And to edit the perspective ruler, you just need to click on any of the purple line. And you can see there are a lot of control points here, but I'm just going to use this control that moves the floor for this tutorial. For the tricks that I'm going to show you here, you can apply this to create many different camera movements, not just parallax. So what we're going to do is to create an animated perspective ruler. I kind of wish we can do this with keyframing, but right now we can't do keyframe on perspective ruler. And even the 2D camera folder won't affect this perspective ruler. So we'll need to create an animation folder for this perspective ruler and animate it manually. So create one, edit and specify the layer. And now when you create a new animation cell, it will duplicate the previous perspective ruler. And this way you can animate the perspective ruler frame by frame. So we got everything we need to know, and let's make the parallax. I have my 2D camera movement plan out already. It's just a simple pan in linear interpolation, and I put all of my background layer under it. We will be using keyframing to offset the movement of each layer with the help of perspective ruler. I'm going to start by measuring the camera speed using this perspective ruler. To do this, you will need to decide a landmark which you will track. You can use any of the corner of the camera, or you can create a new one. So use the floor control and start aligning it until it meets the intersection. Once you have them all, or couple guide, whichever you think is enough, we can move on to the next step, which is making a guide that will help us determine the distance between each plane. The closer you are to the vanishing point, the furthest you are from the camera. So this is my guide which I use for this animation. I use the vector layer since I needed to see them outside of the canvas. Also, this guide is not inside of the 2D camera, so I can move them independently. Now let's begin offsetting each of the layer. I use group for this because I could add in more background elements and I won't have to do keyframing all over again when that happens. So we'll need to go into the camera field of view mode and then enable the keyframing on the folder. For this one, I'll start from the end because I like to have more control on the composition when the camera stops. And you will also need to have a guide inside of the group. I just use a vector layer again for this one and pull a horizontal line, which I will start aligning it to the guide and perspective ruler. And we also need to pick one of this green grid line, as this is another guide that we need for our estimation. So basically, we align all of our guide until it meets in the intersection, and we move to the next frame and start moving it again. Once you have enough keyframe, you can go into the graph window, and since the movement is linear, I could just drag this up and guess where it would end up. You can also go back to see if it's aligned with the guide. Usually it will be roughly correct. You might need to make a bit of adjustment, but I think it's usually within a good range. Next, you just need to do this for every single layer, and once you're done, you can have your parallax. That's about it for this tutorial. It's a bit of workaround, but you can definitely pull off a lot of different camera movement in Clip Studio Paint. Thank you for watching. The next video will be the last one, and I will share even more animation tips. Bye.